Our scripture reading today is from the book of Joshua, chapter 5, verses 13 through 15. Joshua, chapter 5, verses 13 through 15. And it says that it came to pass when Joshua was by Jericho that he lifted his eyes and looked, and behold, a man stood opposite him with his sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went to him and said to him, "Are you for us, or are you our adversary?" And the man said, "No." He said, "No?" He said, "No, but as commander of the army of the Lord, I have now come." And some version says, "Because you called." And Joshua fell on his face to the earth and worshiped. And he said to him, "What does my Lord say to his servant?" Then the commander of the Lord's army said to Joshua, "Take your sandals off your foot, for the place where you stand is holy." And Joshua did so. Word of God's amazing. Amen. God
bless. Good morning. What a privilege. What a treat, what a blessing. Today, 1 year ago, it was the last Sabbath here. This is a wonderful family, a wonderful, wonderful group. Folks, I'm very glad to be here. I got home last night at 3:30 and slept until 6, basically 2 hours and a half, coming from GYC. So I did not sleep last night too much, but I was very happy and very blessed to have the privilege to be with you. And before that came from Dubai, and before that came from Philippines, and so on, doesn't matter. But I want to say before we start, I shared a little in the morning with the others. We live very exceptional times. We live tremendous times. And Satan would want us to be ignorant of the times we live. There are quotations and Bible verses. For instance, in Revelation, it talks about the unity between this and this and the spirits. And you remember, I'm not going to go through it because the sermon is different. And there is a quotation in the spirit of prophecy that says, when the Protestant world will stretch the hand over the abyss and unite to the Catholic Church, then the signs of the end will start. This October, last October, most Protestant churches, not all, and there are, don't even get a wrong idea in your head that we are Adventists, we are good. God loves the Adventist. God loves everybody. God loves everybody the same. But many churches, there were some that did not. Baptist Church did not sign, and others. But Methodist churches, and we don't talk about people, we talk about leadership. Presbyterian churches, Lutheran churches, Anglican churches signed a pact with the Catholic Church and apologized for the Reformation. And they acknowledged the Catholic Church as the leader, as the mother church. And they acknowledge the Pope as the leader of the religious world. These things I have learned since I was a baby. We live those times. Can you process? And then there are quotations that talk about, Bible verses talk about false Christ, you remember? And quotations that talk that Satan would come under strange forms and he will say that he is Christ. Well, look about NASA talking about UFOs. Pictures and so on. Look to the catastrophes, look to the events around, to the law that is ready to get rid of separation of state and church. All these things get together, the preaching of the gospel. We live in exceptional times. I don't have time to go through the stories, but when you see the big picture worldwide, Jesus is coming soon. Besides that, I am overwhelmed to tell you that you guys here, by God's grace, do a work that you may not be aware of. Like, I went to Philippines, and several churches that I visited, they came to me, and they thanked me, and I said, are you kidding? Why? And they said, for what Lexington is doing? And I said, okay. And they said, well, we all experience revival watching the series on Lexington page. That's real. I went to Dubai, MENA, it's Middle East, Northern Africa. It's the most difficult place in the world. The highest population and the lowest number of Christians. It's about one Christian to every like 7,000 people or less. I don't know the number, don't quote that because I could be wrong. But in some of those countries, like Saudi Arabia, you cannot be a Christian. You cannot enter the country. It requires a visa, and you must be a Muslim, and they verify. You don't enter. If they catch you in the country, you are beheaded. There is no joke. In Pakistan, in Iran, if they catch you as a Christian, you lose your life, or in the happiest way, freedom. You lose your freedom forever. So I go there to meet the pastors. And when I meet the pastors in Dubai, because that's the place where they could meet and be free to meet, the pastors from all the MENA come. When I met them, they started to cry. They surrounded me. And they started to cry. And they said, thank you so much. I said, folks, I don't even know you. And they said, when we go to trials, when we are persecuted, when we meet in homes in the night, we listen to the Lexington sermons, and it gives us strength through the trials and faith. I was like, wow! Can you believe what an impact this little church has worldwide? In Vietnam, in New Zealand, in Australia, all over the world. I spoke at GYC yesterday. I got home last night, late in the morning. They came, crowds around, and they said, we all listen to Lexington seminars. Can you believe the impact this church has? Praise the Lord. It's a humbling experience to be allowed to be part of such a wonderful work. Anyway, It's a privilege to be here. I'm not going to go to stories because we could show pictures and tell several hour stories. There are stories, actually, of God's blessing all over. But I'm going to go straight to the subject. Let's bow our heads and then we start. Father, again, we thank you so much for the privilege to come in your presence and worship you. Please touch all of us that nobody would remain the same. May it be for your glory, in Jesus' name, amen. So, folks, we know the story about Joshua and the walls of Jericho. And the walls came tumbling down. It's easy. Don't you know the story? Not a big deal. They went there, the walls came down, they were happy forever. Is it so easy? I'm not sure about that. So what happened? Let's go quick through the story and understand a few things that we somehow don't seem to get. We think that we know. We think that we do things properly. We think that we are good Christians, and we don't know that we don't know, and we don't know how we really are. And we struggle forever until we get these things. And this is going to be crucial, the way you do things. It's going to be crucial for our victory. Moses died. People were wondering who is going to lead them in the promised land. God called Joshua. Long story short, Joshua didn't feel worthy. So he goes before God and says, I am not worthy. I am not prepared. Please be with me. And God says to him, don't be afraid. Be courageous. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. You remember so far? Shake your heads. Okay, you don't sleep. Good. So I will be with you. And then God says, make sure that you obey this law and you'll succeed. We know the story so far. Now, what happened? God said to him, consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow I will do great things. You remember the verse? Among you. And God says to him, tomorrow you will cross Jordan. Is that easy or difficult? What do you think? Well, Joshua knew that they will cross Jordan tomorrow, but God didn't tell him how. And for some reason, sometimes it seems that God is playing games with us because he tells us to do it, but he doesn't tell us how to do it. It's easy to read the story, but if you are in the story, if you are Joshua, you would wonder, I have a crowd of people with me. How do we cross Jordan? Now, if you know anything about Jordan, those people that have been there, Jordan is from here to that bench, and it's so deep. And this is, I crossed Jordan. Really, I was there. But twice a year, at the beginning of April, in the middle of October, Jordan, in the rainy season, is 2 miles wide. And extremely fast. You cannot swim. And it comes from the mountains with trees that are broken by the flood, and it destroys everything in the way. Homes cannot stand. Anything that is in the way is taken away. In that season, you cannot swim. You die. That season is when they got at Jordan. And God says, tomorrow you are going to cross Jordan. God tells him, tell the priests to step into the water carrying the Ark of the Covenant. But God doesn't tell them, listen, I'm going to do a miracle, take the water, and then you can walk. For some reason, God doesn't do the miracle. He wants you to step in faith. We know the story. And so what happens? God says, this is how you cross the river. You have the Ark of the Covenant ahead, going before you first into the water. Do you want, what is the Ark of the Covenant? It was God's presence. It was Shekinah. It was God's presence, the mercy seat and the Ten Commandments, the justice and the grace that go together. God is just and God is love. And they together are the blessing that God gave us, his presence. And God says, you are not to go alone in this endeavor. You are not to cross Jordan alone. If you want to cross Jordan, you need to have my presence go before you. And that's the way you cross Jordan. And so, what happens? When the priest, nothing happened before. For some reason, God has this habit that I don't like. God doesn't do the miracle until the last moment. The last second, not the last minute. Nothing happened until they literally stepped into the water. I don't even want to imagine how it was if I was them. When they stepped into the water, just then the miracle happened and the waters went left and right and they walked on dry land through the water. Now, I'm not going to talk about this slide because we have no time. It's about a whole page talking about the Canaan nations, how they worship Satan and how they sacrifice babies and so on and so forth. I'm going to jump over it. But go to the next one. What did they do to consecrate themselves? Joshua, hold on a second. Okay. At Gilgal, at the border with Canaan, after they crossed Jordan and they came close to the walls and they were in Canaan in a dangerous zone, Joshua circumcised them. Now think about it. Women, children, elderly could not fight. And men that could fight were circumcised. Are you good for war? Uh-uh. For a few days, they are all handicapped. That was not smart. Was it? For some reason, God wants you to be incapable to do the war so you know that he does the war. And God cannot use you before he breaks you. Because there is nothing in us that would really fight the battle, though we may think that we can do it. And God says, the way you fight the battle, you become nothing. And you consecrate yourself entirely and depend on me entirely. And I fight the battle. Basically, they could have been attacked by those nations and they had no way to defend themselves. Do you think that that was fun? When God leads you, it's not fun. God doesn't call you to comfort. God calls you to full surrender and full trust. That's the way we fight. And so what happened? Joshua knew that they are absolutely exposed and in danger. So Joshua, because he was a man of prayer, and patriarchs and prophets say, quote, he didn't pray only in crisis or in need, but he prayed as a lifestyle. Listen carefully. Joshua didn't pray only routine prayer, morning, evening, and meals. Joshua didn't pray only in need, but his prayer was a life, was the breath of the soul. He prayed all the time. He prayed when things were good. He prayed when things were bad. He prayed all the time. Joshua was a man of prayer. That's how we should pray. He knew that they are exposed, so he went to a secluded place, it says in the Bible, to pray and seek God's help and leading. So as he goes to prayer, a stranger comes with a sword. And Joshua jumps up and says, hey, are you for us or against us? And the stranger says, I am for you. Does it? No. I am against you. Huh? He says, neither. I'm the captain of the army of the Lord. And I came because you called me. And Joshua says, We have this situation. We have this crisis in our life. What do you want me to do? And God says, get the swords and train the people and have a board meeting and devise a plan, and this is how you succeed. Does he? Nonsense! This is how you are going to fight. Take your shoes off. That doesn't make any sense. Does it? When God tells you what to do, it's crazy. If it's not crazy, it's your brain. If it's God, it must be crazy. Build an ark. Why? It's going to rain. What is rain? It's crazy. When God tells you what to do, doesn't make sense. Therefore, you should not try to logically understand God in order to obey. Faith is when you don't understand, but know who you talk with and trust. And so, God says, this is how you fight. Take your shoes off. What does he mean? Let's go into it. They are at the border with Jericho. Jericho is the greatest city in the whole nation. The greatest army. There are literally giants. They have the biggest army. They have the biggest walls. The city is 10 acres wide. In that time, big deal. The walls are 12 feet tall, 8 feet wide. I've been there. I've seen the ruins. Rock, wood, steel, wood, rock. Wide, 2, 3, 4 chariots could drive on the top of the walls in the same time, parallel. In the walls, homes, windows like this, that you could not shoot inside, but from inside you could shoot arrows and kill everybody outside. Very dangerous place to be under the walls. They could throw arrows and rocks and anything and kill them in no time. Basically, around the walls, you were exposed. It was suicide mission. It was crazy to just be there under the walls. For some reason, God likes to do that, you know? Anyway, so it was the key to the whole country. Now, as they get to Jericho, a little about Jericho. Jericho, the name, comes from the word. Hold on a second. Okay, found it. The word Yarech, that means the goddess moon. Basically, their center of worship was the moon. It's located 825 feet below the sea level, the single place on earth that you can fly an F-16 jet under the sea level. Yes. And above, about 460 above Dead Sea, that is the lowest place on earth. And Jericho is fortified, strong walls, strong army, greatest city in the country. And they are supposed to go to war against Jericho and have no swords. And God says, don't take a sword with you. Does it make any sense? It's easy for you because you know the story. But if you are them, would have been easy for you? When God tells you tomorrow to do something with doubt, think about that situation. And so, let's move on. Joshua realizes that he's totally dependent on God. And God allows you to go in those crisis situations that you understand that you depend on him entirely and you don't think that you in your power and wisdom can solve the problem. So, he says, Lord, I need your presence. We depend on you. We need you. And he says, when he's praying, the Bible says that the stranger comes with a sword. Now let me ask you a question. The stranger comes with a sword. Number one, you need to remember, when you go through crisis, when you go through war, when you go through trials, this is how you fight. You don't fight with a sword. You don't fight with method. You don't fight with wisdom. You don't fight trying to solve problems. You don't fight like people, good people, Christian, good Adventists fight. Jacob, God is unable to help me get the birthright. So I'm going to devise. God gave me the promise. Oh, God is good. I trust him. But God needs a little help. I'm going to put the skins. I am Esau, and I got it. Do you follow me? I'm going to put the branches in the water, and the sheep come the color that I need, and I got it. I can devise a plan. I'm going to sleep with my servant, and God promised me a baby, Abraham, you know, and I'm going to help God, because God cannot help. You don't fight the war by devising a plan. You fight the war by going to prayer and seeking God's presence. That's how you fight the war. Otherwise, you make a mess. You seek God's presence. Joshua realizes that they cannot fight this crisis. And therefore, he goes to prayer. That's how we are supposed to fight if we are Christians. And then as he prays, he sees a man, a stranger. Now, this is what the man tells him. Don't take swords, take the priests, take the Ark of the Covenant, and blow the shofar. No sword, no weapon should be used. How can you go to war with no weapons? Just carry the Ark of the Covenant and the shofar and blow the trumpet. Are you crazy? What was the meaning? They had several instruments and several trumpets and several songs. A song to call people to the war. A song to call people for assembly. A song, different melodies like in the army. That's wake up. That's come to meal. I know because I blew the trumpet in the army. Really, I had good life. I would blow the trumpet and go back to sleep and let the soldiers. It was good. I had good life. You know. But there were melodies that had different meaning. However, there was one that was different. When they didn't blow the trumpets, but they blew the shofar. When they blew the shofar, that shofar, I don't know, I'll get there in a second. That shofar had a specific song that was used for nothing else but to call God. And that was blown every Friday night, that melody, to invite God's presence for the Sabbath. And that melody was played at Sinai when God's presence came and gave them the law. Do you follow me? When they blew the shofar, basically going around the walls, what they did, they called God's presence to fight the fight. That's how you fight your battles. You don't fight your battles by sword and wisdom. You find your battles, if you are a Christian, by calling God's presence into the battle. And so, let's move on. No assault was to be made. They were simply to walk around the city, carrying the ark, God's presence, and then at the end of the tour, they were supposed to blow the shofar. Does it make any sense? Now we know the story. We understand it makes sense. But for them, they didn't know the future. They didn't know what's going to happen. How do you fight the war? When God tells you to do it, you don't need to make logic. You don't need to understand. You just need to trust and obey. There is no other way. You understand? You just need to learn to trust your God. And the reason we struggle so much is because we never fully surrender. We say we trust God, but we are not secure, and we need to do something ourselves. And why do we need to do something ourselves? Because we don't spend enough time in prayer and study of the Word to know our God enough to have peace, that He loves us and He will take care of it. And so, they are not to conquer in their power, but by obedience and faith. That's how Christians fight. We have this habit. If I go to church and keep Sabbath and eat broccoli, God is going to answer my prayers and bless me and save me. It's paganism. You do this so God can do that. You don't please God and earn merit by doing this. This is how you are saved. You call God's presence and say, Lord, I'm nothing. I depend on you entirely, not only on my salvation, but on my daily struggle every day. Without you, John 15, separated from you, I am nothing. Please come into my heart. Just come, I need you. That's how Christians fight the fight. And so, we talked about the shofar. We are not going to talk again. Let's move on. Number one, when you go to war, you don't fight the battle. You don't devise the plan. You don't go and have 2 hours board meeting, have a plan, and then act. You go and have 2 hours prayer meeting, and then you go to war. And so, number one, you see God's presence. Number two, you need to realize that the battle is not yours. The battle belongs to the Lord. That God is in the middle of your crisis. That God is in the middle of your battle. God is right there. Often we are so focused on our crisis, on our problem, that we don't recognize God in the crisis. Joshua prays, Lord, please help me. And he sees a stranger. And he says, oh, are you for me or against me? He didn't realize that was no stranger, that was God. Jacob, he's fighting a stranger. That was God. Disciples on the water. Jesus comes walking on the water. They start screaming, a ghost. That was no ghost. That was God. A ghost. We are going to perish. It was not an enemy attacking Jacob. It was God helping him. For some reason, when God comes to help us, we think it's an enemy trying to destroy us. And we confuse God and the means that God is using to save you with our problems. It's not a problem. It's God working to save you and growing you. Do you follow me? The battle that you have tomorrow is not the enemy trying to destroy you. It's not a stranger. It's God trying to make you. Because God is alive. God is not in vacation. God is not asleep. God is real. And if he didn't want it to happen, he would have said no. But if he said yes, it means that you need it. And God says, for your growth, you need faith. You need dependence on me. You need patience. You need love. For your salvation, you need to go through the furnace because otherwise you'll never be pure. Therefore, I allow this in your life. Stop solving it. You're going to repeat the class again. It's time for you to pass the class and move to the second grade. Don't try to solve. This is crazy. We go to God and we ask him, Lord, please give me patience and help me love you and help me love people. And God says, okay. And this is how God gives you patience. He sends trials, so you learn patience. And then you say, would you please solve the trials? He says, didn't you ask for it? Do you understand? We ask for it, and then we pray that God will solve it. Doesn't make any sense. When you say, Lord, grow me, that's how God grows you. He throws you in the fiery furnace, and he teaches you dependence and love and humbleness and dependence and patience and the lessons that you need to grow to the fullness of stature of Christ. And when you get in the fiery furnace, you complain and whine, Lord, solve it. And we fix our eyes on the crisis, and we don't recognize God in the crisis. And we say, it's the enemy. It's not the enemy. It is God who sent it. Stop seeing an enemy in the way God works for you. We are often so focused on the trial that we don't see God in the middle of the trial. Can it be that the very thing we think is our problem is in fact God working for your salvation? Think all the examples in the Bible again and again. Can it be that what God allows for you to save you, you think it's a trial against you? Do you remember that all things work together for the benefit of those who love the Lord? If you realize that, stop struggling. Stop fixing your eyes on trials. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Satan would love you to keep your eyes on the trials and get discouraged. God wants you to fix your eyes, not on the walls, not on the giants, not on the battle, but fix your eyes upon Jesus. That's what Christians do. Now, it gets a little more complicated than that. It doesn't move. It died. We need to pray for resurrection. Okay. Let's see. Oh, it works again. Praise the Lord. We are not called to fight. For some reason, we always, again and again, struggle to solve our problems. Abraham trying to help God have a baby. God doesn't need help to give you a baby. God can say and it happens, but he does it in the best time, in the best way. You don't need to help God. God is able. God doesn't need your help. For some reason, we forget that. And so what do? We think that we are called to fight the fight. You are not called to fight the fight. The battle belongs to the Lord. We need to get it. God is for you. You say, are you for me, Lord, or you are for my enemy? He gave Jesus on the cross. He is for you. If you talk about the real enemy, God, are you for me or for my enemy? Satan? How could God be for Satan? God is for you. And if you talk about your neighbor, God, are you for me or with my neighbor? God is neither. Oh, God, are you a Democrat or a Republican? Always trying to divide. God says, love one another as the Father and I love one another. God didn't call you to get your justice and to support your ideas and to help you against the other. God called you to love the other. Regardless, it's easy to love those that you agree with. Love those that you don't agree with. That's when you are like Jesus. You see so much division and so much separation in our society. Why are we Christians if we don't behave like Christ? God didn't call you that he would sacrifice others for you. God called you that you would sacrifice you for others. Do you pray for others as much as you pray for you? Do you spend for others as much as you spend for you? Because God said, love your neighbor just as you love self. You say, oh, I love Jesus. No, we don't. Because if we love Jesus, we love his children. Do you follow me? How could you love God that you don't see? It's easy to say, I love God. That's baloney. Oh, but we go to church. Pharisees did go to church better than we do. Love your enemy with compassion, with crazy love, and say, Lord, you can lose me, but I'm going to ask you to save them. That's when you are like Jesus. And so, we start worrying because we focus on us and we think God is the enemy and we think that God should be on our side. We should not ask God to be on our side. We should ask that we are on God's side. I don't know if you understand, but we kind of have twisted things. Basically, God says, stop fighting. It's not your business how you win the battle. It's not your business how you are saved. You'll be saved in quietness and repentance and peace and serenity. Not fighting, but praying. You'll be saved by loving others. And let me fight the fight. Let me fight your crisis. Let me give you salvation. I am able to finish what I started in your life. I love you, and I'm going to save not only the thief on the cross, I'm going to save every one of you. But you need to understand that you need to love me, and you need to love your neighbor. That's Christianity. It's not the things that we do, but it's when we become like Christ. And so, let's move on a little. Lord, what do you want me to do in this war? And God says, get a training and train them how to use the sword. That's what he says. Have a board meeting, a device, a plan. God says, I give you the strategy. Very simple. Take your shoes off. That doesn't make sense. You don't fight Jericho taking your shoes off. You got to be crazy to do that. Do you get it? In their tradition, when they went in God's presence in the sanctuary, they took shoes off. People that had shoes were free. People that had no shoes were slaves. And when they took their shoes off in God's presence, they said, you are the master. You are the Lord. We are the servants. You tell us what to do, and we do it. We, for some reason, always tell God what to do. It should be the other way around. Stop telling God what to do. Let him tell you what to do. Stop asking God to serve you. It's time that we understand God called us to serve him. Stop assigning God a place in your army. God needs to assign you a place in his army. Stop asking God to take your side. You need to take God's side. For some reason, we think we are the master and we tell God what to do. We need to understand who does what. And so we need to learn that God comes first, not our trials, not our help, not our salvation. God comes first, and then worship comes second, and then service comes third, and so on. And the battles belong to the Lord. We are not called to fight the fight. We are called to love and to serve. That's what Christians do. That know the Lord and trust the Lord. But that requires faith. Because it says there that those who wait upon the Lord renew their strength. That means that you don't go to war. You go to prayer. And you wait until God works. We don't have the patience to wait. If God doesn't work today, I'm going to do it myself. People who spend time in prayer and know the Lord, they wait for God's work. They don't feel the need. They don't trust self to do the work. Don't seek God's blessing for your plan. Seek his plan. It is not the capabilities that you possess or ever will have that will give you success. It is that what the Lord can do for you. We need to have less confidence in self and more confidence in God. He longs that we reach after him by faith. He longs to have us expect great things from him. Now, folks, let's move on a little because it gets even more complicated. God says to him, I have delivered, that's past tense, before it happened. God knows the future. For him, tomorrow is like today. 1,000 years in advance is like today. And he sees the whole picture, and we don't. We are blind. And God says, stop looking for a solution because you don't see the picture. He says, I see it. You are victorious. I see you already in heaven. I see you on the other side. You don't get it. Stop looking for solutions. Stop looking for how to do it. You are victorious. If you keep looking to Jericho, you'll get depressed. Satan wants you to get depressed. I need you to keep your eyes on me. And this is how you are going to do it. I'm going to tell you the method. You should not devise the method. It should not be your strategy asking for his blessing. It's going to be my strategy. This is how you do it. And God tells him, walk around the city 6 days. Don't do nothing. Don't talk. Don't have swords. Just walk. What is going to do to the walls if I walk around the walls? That's crazy. In the 7 day, walk 7 times. Now, we have this habit. If we kind of doubt when God says, do that, we don't do it. But then finally we do it. And then 2nd day we do it. And 3rd day we get used. And after 6 days, hey, I got it. I learned the drill. And then we keep doing that, assuming that if that was good yesterday, it's going to be good tomorrow. And then we become Pharisees doing the same thing again and again. And we think that our experience from 10 years ago is going to be good tomorrow. No, folks. God has a new strategy tomorrow. And the strategy from yesterday is not good anymore. God wants you to seek his plan every day, not use his plan from yesterday as forever. God wants you to pray and wait every day. Because he has a new plan every day. And those who learn to depend on God every day have victory. God says, no, you didn't get it. 7 days, don't walk again. You walk 7 times. What's the point? Just do it. Just obey. Just do it. Don't argue. Don't try to understand God. Unless you are God, you cannot understand God. That's dangerous, Lord. We are going to walk 7 times around the walls. Yeah, just do it. And then 7th time, this is what you do. You blow the trumpets. This is what's going to do to the walls if we blow the trumpets. Well, let's analyze a little. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean in your understanding. You will fight this battle not with your wisdom, but by worshiping and obeying and trusting God. You're supposed to have the Ark of the Covenant go ahead, and you're supposed to blow the shofar. God's presence was called. Now listen, when they blew the shofar, when they called God's presence, then the walls came down. It is not your wisdom and methods that would give you victory, but it is God's presence that would do the job. So, God will give you the strategy, But the battle is not about you. It's about God. Because God says, this is what you need to do. You need to take your shoes off because this is holy ground. What we really need to understand is this point. Every battle is holy ground. Every day, every crisis that we go through, every trial, every problem that we have, is holy ground is not in the church one day a week. And worship is not in the church one day a week. And sanctuary is not in the church one day a week in this place. Holy ground is every day in every trial, regardless how small. God says, in that situation, take, it was not in the temple, it was not in the synagogue, it was not in the church, it was in desert. God says, take your shoes off because this crisis is holy ground. God says, I want you to see in every crisis holy ground. I want you to see me in the crisis, not the crisis. I want you to understand that this is not a crisis. This is an opportunity that I give you that you can know me, experience me, and learn trust and grow. I want you to understand that God is using what you think as a crisis, as a problem, as enemy. God is using actually for you. What you think that is against you is for you. It's not a crisis. It is God. And so, the battle is holy ground. You don't grow one day a week listening to a sermon. The greatest growth happens when you are in hospital. The greatest growth happens when you lose a job. The greatest growth happens in the daily crisis. That's when you learn to trust the Lord. Growth, sanctuary, worship should be every second, every trial, every day. Christians worship God every day. And so, you are not called to be right. You are not called to defend self, but to sacrifice self. Stop trying to use God to promote what you do or help you in what you do. You need to promote what he does and help him in his plan. It's not about you getting God's support for your agenda. It's about you supporting God's agenda. Turn things around. It's not about God helping you to go over the crisis. It's about you helping God in his work. Your job is to serve God, love your neighbor, worship, sacrifice. His job is to defend you. He says, if you allow me to be your God, if you worship me, if you trust in me, I'm going to give you the country. I'm going to give you homes that you didn't build. I'm going to give you gardens that you didn't plant. I'm going to give you victory over armies greater than you. I'm going to put the law into your heart and into your mind. You cannot obey the law, but I'm going to give you a new heart. Not a stone, but fleshy heart. I will do all of this. You don't need to fight the fight. The battle belongs to me. You don't need to fight the crisis. What you need to learn to trust me and worship me and have a relationship with me. That's how Christians fight. You say that you are for me? If you are for me, love, serve. Don't worry about the other things. Seek first the kingdom of God, not the salvation of the kingdom for you. The translation from Greek is the prosperity, the advance of the kingdom. If you are for me, keep serving. That's what I called you to do. And if you seek the kingdom of God, God says, I promise that the other things will be provided. Do you believe that God is able and he keeps his promise. He will provide all other things. If you do, then obey, seek first, the prosperity of his kingdom and forget self. There is a quotation in the spirit of prophecy that says, when we focus on self and try to get God help self, we reflect, quote, Satan's character. Ooh, that's kind of tough. I had a thought to erase it from the Mount of Blessings. You know, I said, this is too harsh. When we seek help for self, we reflect Satan's character. Jesus was nothing about self. Jesus came not to be served, but to serve. Not to have people sacrifice for him, but that he would sacrifice himself for others. If you want to be like Jesus, you forget self and fully surrender and say, Lord, take my life, but please save my neighbor. Lord, give me the city where I die. Give me Lexington. Lord, please, for my friends, you forget self. Then he works for you. We always fight our battles, and we don't get it. God fights the battles. We are called to serve. That's our job. And so, let's move on, because it's late. and I'm hungry. I didn't eat breakfast. If you give yourself to God to serve him and do his work, you don't need to be anxious for tomorrow. He whose servant you are, he knows the end from the beginning. He knows the events of tomorrow that you don't know. He has the power to take care of it. Now listen carefully. No one prays right seeking a blessing for self. Wow. We are so self-centered, aren't we? When Christ's character will be reproduced in his children, then Jesus will come. This is how you do evangelism. You love people with all your heart, and you ask God to put in you passion for people. And when you love them, people will know, and that's the best evangelism. Then, when you do evangelism, people will come, not because we have the truth and we are smarter and we are better. We are not. But people will come because they see Jesus in us. That's how you do evangelism. Being like Jesus. Now, Joshua is ready to fight. For some reason, we are always ready to fight. Some people even fight before they know what they fight. Yes, have you seen them? They jump and then they say, but what happened? They don't even know who they fight and why, but they first fight and then they ask. And some people, the other extreme, never fight. Brother, say something so we know that you didn't die. They are always, don't care. Both in the ditch. We need to learn that we do have a responsibility. Noah was supposed to build the ark. Am I right? Abraham was supposed to leave his country or sacrifice his. We do have something to do, but not what we think. We need to do what God says. And our job is to seek his strategy, not ask him to bless our strategy. We have a responsibility, but we need to seek his plan. Do you follow me? Therefore, we need to understand that we cannot assign God a place in our army. We need to allow him to assign us a place in his army. We need to understand that we don't ask God to get our victories, but we ask God to let us get his victories. And we need to forget self, sacrifice self. Our trials should not be our concern. Faith, love, service, relationship should be our concern. Trials are his concern. Do you follow me? We need to change a little the way we see things if we call ourselves Christians. Every single battle is crucial, is holy ground. You cannot complain, I have a crisis tomorrow. That crisis is used by God to grow you. God is in the crisis. God sent the crisis. Instead of looking to the crisis, put your eyes on God and learn. More than that, before you go to war, you need to encounter God. You cannot go against Jericho before you worship God, before you realize that God is there, before you have God's presence. You don't fight the enemy. You need to worship God. He fights the enemy. Now, I need to move on a little. This is what got my attention. Oh, by the way, you know the song? In heavenly armor we enter the land. The battle belongs to the Lord. That's how it happens. This is something that got my attention. When we take in our hands the management of things which we have to do and depend on our own wisdom, we take a burden that God never intended for us, that it is his job. And we take upon ourselves the responsibility that belongs to God and put ourselves in his place. And then the quotation is a little too long, and it says there, it's not too long, but it's just too long for me to put it on the screen. And it says there that we make ourselves gods and show that we don't trust in him, but we rather trust in ourselves. Can you realize that we do that daily? And then she says, but we, if we really believe that God loves us and he has the means and the power and the desire to help us, then we stop worrying about our trials. And then our problems disappear. Isn't that nice? The real battle is not what you see as your crisis. It's not what you go through, that you lost your job, that you have problems in the family. That's not the real battle. Satan has no interest to take your house or job. Satan doesn't need your house. Satan is after your faith. And we focus on the house, and we focus on the health, and we focus on this, what we see, is not the real battle. The battle is spiritual. Satan is trying to make you keep your eyes on Jericho instead of you keeping your eyes on God. That's the battle. Anyway, the battle that you fight tomorrow requires an encounter with God today. The victory of tomorrow depends on your relationship with God today. You'll never see the walls come down before you see Jesus coming into your heart. That's how we should fight the battle. Otherwise, we will never have victory. Basically, every day challenge is not a crisis, but an opportunity, a sanctuary. It's an opportunity to worship God, experience Him, and learn faith and dependence and trust. You don't need wisdom or fight or sword. You need to take your shoes off and recognize God in the middle of the trial and say, Lord, I need you. I don't need to solve the problem. I don't need to fight. I just need you. This is the way you take the walls down. And so, for some reason, we think that we are called to fight, we are called to solve, we are called to do, instead of calling to have relationship. We need to understand, it's not about you or me. It's not about us getting God's support for our plans. It's not about us getting help, God help for our problems. It's about us supporting God's plans. It's about God, us supporting God's work. That's our job. Sanctuary is in every place. Sanctuary, worship, is in every battle. It's every day, in every situation. Every crisis that we go through, it's a sanctuary. The greatest moments of worship and growth happen not in the church, but in hospital, in the life, in the trials. Rejoice in the Lord always. Thank Him for all things. Praise Him for the battle. Praise Him for the crisis. Put your eyes on Him, and the worldly things will go strangely dim. That's where we need to grow. Now, what happened to Jericho? We get close to the end of the story. What happened to Jericho? Eventually, the walls, without human touch, without human methods or strategy or plans, the walls came down. Think about the past, how God has led you in the past. You had crises before that you were like, ah! And if you go back 5-10 years, God worked all of them. We have nothing to fear unless we shall forget how God has led us in the past. This crisis that you go through will also disappear. And this Jericho will come down and will never be built again. And when Jericho is no more, you'll still be standing there. Because God says, I love you more than life. There is a quotation in the spiritual prophecy that says, God loves us exactly how much He loves Jesus. Can you grasp that? That God gave His Son for you and for me. And He says, I love you. How can you wonder if I am for you? These walls will come down. I have given you a victory. Jericho will be no more, will never be built. This crisis you'll never see again. When the crisis is gone, you will still be there standing. I have inscribed you on my palms. Even if the mountains move, my love will never move from you. I love you. But because we fix our eyes on Jericho, we don't see God. So therefore, God says, I'm going to deliver you. When I deliver you completely. But this is what you need to learn. The battle belongs to me, not to you. You just need to know me and worship me and serve me. That's your part. Now, folks, the last one, shout of victory. They were told, crazy, to walk around the walls and 7 times to say, wah! Now, if you go in history, In the Israel history, they shouted always after they got victory. It's easy to shout after the battle. But God wants you to trust him so much that you shout before. That's Christianity. Go home. May God answer your prayer. May you have a baby. She goes home, she anoints herself, and she eats, and she says, I am pregnant. There is nothing moving inside. She's not pregnant. It takes another 2-3 years before she's pregnant. But she says, I know my God. If he says so, it happened. It's a matter of time. Anna, you remember the story? God says, go to war and put the choir in front of the army. And Jehoshaphat puts the choir and they say, praise the Lord, he gave us victory. He didn't. It was supposed to happen tomorrow. Christians that spend time looking to God, not to trials, they shout before it happens because they know God. I know my Redeemer. I know I will see him. I don't care if I live or die. I know him. Louisa Steed, you remember the story. She lost her husband. She was sleeping in Central Park in the winter on a bench with a 3-year-old girl in her arms for several weeks. No food, no warmth. In the winter in New York, in Central Park. And she was praying for a job, and she was praying for a place, an apartment, and nothing happened. God didn't seem to care. And in that situation, she composes the song, "'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus." She didn't compose the song after she had an apartment and the job. She composed the song, and she was singing like a Muppet with the mouth to the ears. Happy. It is so sweet to trust it when she was sleeping on the bench. Why? Because she spent the time looking to God, not looking to the crisis. And she says, yes, I go through trial, but I know my God. He gave Jesus. He loves me. He's working on me. I need it. So Lord, help me know you and trust you. Whatever lesson I need to grow like Jesus, make me like Jesus. Thank you for the trial. That's what Christians do. They shout in faith. Basically, God wants you to believe before it happens based on relationship and faith. That's what he wants to teach us, folks. That's the fight that we have. Not to fight the enemies, not to fight the walls and Jericho and the giants. That belongs to the Lord. And so, don't look to the walls. Don't talk about it. Don't think about it. Don't let your heart be troubled. My father said, birds fly over the head. Don't let them make a nest in your head. Doubts, temptation fly when they sit down. Pew, say, get behind me, Satan. Don't talk trials. Don't talk negative. Don't pray whining prayers. Praise the Lord in faith. Say, Lord, I know you. I am in trouble. Go before the walls of Jericho and start screaming, I am victorious. And people say, are you crazy? The walls are still there. You are still without a job. You are still in the bench in the park. Why do you praise him? And you say, because I know him. That's faith. Talk about God. Don't talk about problems. Talk faith. Sing faith. Pray faith. Rejoice in faith. That's what Christians do. That honors God. That allows God. Only by faith we are saved. It is faith. Without faith, it's impossible to even benefit of any of God's blessings. That's what Christians do. And so, I'll rejoice in the Lord even in my trials. I'll be joyful. Isn't that nice? I will trust in the Lord. I'm not afraid. For the Lord is my, it's not me, it's not my method. I don't need to solve it. The Lord is my strength. He has become my salvation. What no eyes have seen, this is what he has prepared for you. That's what you need to talk about. That's what you need to focus on. That's how you need to decide to fight your battles. Then he just taste. And see how good he is. Then he will fight for you. He will go before you. He's going to go before you. And before you get to the war, he's going to give you victory. When you get there, you don't need to fight. You just pick up the spoil. Let God be your God. Let him be God. Basically, never allow yourself to think and talk in a hopeless way, discouraged way. You lose. By looking to problems and complaining, you give evidence of sickly, feeble faith. Talk and act as your faith was invincible. Be crazy. Christians must be crazy. Be crazy. Jump and scream when you have a problem and say, Remember Mueller. I don't know, probably you know the story. You read it on the internet. He had to speak in Quebec, and he was traveling on a boat from England. And as he was traveling on the boat, it was crazy fog. And the captain said, we cannot move forward. It's too much fog. And Miller said, in 52 years, I've never been late for an appointment. You need to keep moving. The captain said, you are crazy. We don't move. He says, well, I'm going to pray, and the fog goes away. And the captain says, you are crazy. And Miller goes in the bottom room, says, Captain, come here. And Miller prays, says, Lord, you sent me to speak there. Please take the fog. Thank you. Okay, now we can move. Start the boat. And the captain says, do I need to pray too? No, because you don't believe. And because it already happened. Why keep asking? The fog is not there anymore. And the captain says, how do you know? He says, just go upstairs and look. And this is a real story. You can read it. The captain goes upstairs, and he looks, and the fog is no more. And then the captain told the story. You need to rejoice. You need to know your God. The battle is on your knees. It's worshiping. That's how Christians fight. Look to him. Talk about him. Praise him. Know him. Trust in him. That honors God and grows you like Christ. And so, shout of victory. Exercise faith. That's how you end. So, Father, we pray that you help us starting today. Learn to focus on you. Learn to trust you in all things. Learn to seek your presence instead of seeking solutions. Learn to obey in whatever you say. Help us become like Jesus. Help us have a passion for you and a passion for people and serve you. Father, we pray that you will just grow us every day according to your grace and wisdom and plan. We pray in Jesus' precious name, and thank you, Lord, for answering. We love you and we pray.